In the last video, we designed a 1-bit bimodal predictor. So we said that for a given branch, branch 1, I will track its PC address, and then I'll have a 1-bit entry that says, is this taken or not taken, right? And so accordingly, there'll be a 1 or a 0, and then where I'm jumping to, which might be, say, PC3. Okay, and you know, based on this predictor, I was able to achieve an accuracy of close to 87% for the sample code. Okay, and now I'm going to try and improve on this basic predictor. Instead of just keeping track of 1 bit, which tells me what I did last time, I'm going to grow this entry to have a 2-bit value, and accordingly, this value means something, right? Obviously, a 00 will mean that I'm strongly biased towards this branch being not taken. A 01 will mean that I'm mildly in favor of not taking this branch. A 10 will mean that I'm mildly in favor of taking this branch. And a 11 will mean that I'm strongly in favor of taking this branch. Okay, so depending on the value in this 2-bit entry, I will decide if the branch is strongly taken or strongly not taken, or if my prediction is somewhat mildly being taken or not taken. Okay, so this is the gray area that I was referring to in the last video. Okay, but regardless of me being strongly biased or mildly biased, ultimately I need to make a recommendation of whether the branch should be taken or not. Okay, so I look at the most significant bit of this entry, and that tells me what I should do, right? So in this case, the prediction will be not taken. So it doesn't matter if I'm strongly biased or mildly biased, the prediction will be not taken. And likewise over here, the prediction will be to be taken regardless of whether this is a strong or a mild prediction. Okay, so how does having a 2-bit value help me? Okay, so let's look at how these entries are first computed. Let's say that I start out by having the entry as 00. Every time the branch is taken, I increment this value. So it's really a counter which gets incremented, or it gets decremented when I don't take the branch. So every time the branch is not taken, I decrement the counter. Okay, so as the branch gets taken, it increments to 01. Then as it gets taken again, it becomes 10. Gets taken again, it becomes 11. So having seen the branch being taken 3 consecutive times, I now am strongly in favor of predicting that the branch will be taken in the future. Okay, and this is called a saturating counter, because now if the branch is taken again, I have to increment it yet again. Okay, but 11 plus 1 ends up being 11. Okay, so it does not overflow, it does not wrap around and become 0 again. Okay, so once you have reached the maximum value of 3, if you try incrementing again, it stays at 3. And likewise, if you are already at 0 and you try decrementing it again, it stays at 0. So that's why it is called a saturating counter. So this is called a saturating 2-bit counter. Okay, and why exactly does this help me? Okay, so let's say that the branch was taken a whole bunch of times. It is now at 11. Okay, and now for some reason, the branch decides the branch is not taken once. Accordingly, I have to decrement my counter, and it becomes 10. So the next time I encounter this branch, what prediction am I going to make? I'm going to look at the most significant bit, and that is still a 1. So I'm going to predict taken. So what it means is, just because the branch was not taken once, doesn't mean I throw my prediction out of the window and I change my opinion and decide that the branch is not taken. Right? So if, just because the branch was not taken once, I'm not changing my prediction altogether, right? Since I've seen this branch being taken a whole bunch of times in the recent past, I'm still going to be biased towards taken. It's just that instead of being strongly biased, I'm now mildly biased. Okay, so I'm not changing my opinion just because of one not taken branch. And now if the branch is taken again, I go back to being strongly biased. Or if the branch is not taken again, then it goes down to 01. So at this point, I now change my prediction. Okay, so in order to go from strongly taken to making a not taken prediction, I have to see the branch being not taken a couple of times. It's not enough to just see one random not taken branch to change my opinion. Okay, and this really helps for the for loop example that we'd seen before, right? Because over here, let's look at what is the true outcome of that branch. Right, so you take the branch a bunch of times, I think 9 times, and then there's a not taken prediction. Then you again go back to the branch being taken a whole bunch of times and then not taken, and so on. Okay, and likewise, you know, before you get here, there's a not taken branch. All right, so now, you know, what my predictor says, so the predictor, having encountered taken branches so often, the value is usually in a 1-1 at this point, 1-1, 1-1. Then after it sees a 0, it becomes a 1-0, but then it sees a 1 again, so it goes back to 1-1, 1-1, 1-1, and so on. Okay, so if you look at the most significant bit of the predictor, it's always a 1. So this predictor is always predicting taken. And just because the branch was not taken once, you don't change your prediction the next time you come around. And that helps you make a correct decision for your very first loop iteration. Okay, so as you go through these loop iterations, you're correct 9 times because the branch is taken. And then finally, when you're supposed to exit the loop, your predictor still says, I think you're going to be taken, and that prediction is wrong. So 9 out of 10 predictions are correct over here, and 19 out of 20 predictions are correct over here. So my total accuracy goes to 28 by 30, which is about 93%. Okay, so my 1-bit predictor, which was only keeping track of what I did last time, was giving me an 87% prediction because I was wrong twice for every for loop. Now, since I'm keeping track of the common case, I'm not just keeping track of what happened last time. You know, my history is capturing more than just what happened last time. It's capturing what has happened in the last few times. And that helps me refine my prediction. It ensures that just because I exited the loop last time, I'm not going to change my prediction altogether, right? I still predict taken the next time I enter the for loop, and that happens to be correct. So I'm only wrong when I exit the loop, and that has cut down my mispredictions by a factor of 2. Okay, so this is called a 2-bit, this is a 2-bit bimodal saturating counter, or saturating counter predictor. All right, and you know, before I move on and start developing even more sophisticated predictors, let me just explain, you know, how these tables are actually constructed and how they are accessed. Okay, so the way I've been describing it so far, I've been assuming that as you encounter branches, you keep creating entries in the table. So you put in, you know, for branch 1, I put in an entry over here saying this corresponds to PC1, this is the outcome, it's going to jump to PC3, then I encounter branch 2 and I stick it in over here, and so on. Okay, so now next time when I encounter a branch, you know, let's say I encounter branch 1, so I'm at PC1, okay, which is at some branch. If I need to look up the predictor, I have to say, well, is there an entry for me? And how do I figure that out? I have to take PC1 and I have to compare it against all of the entries over here. Okay, and then one of them will match and it says, well, this is the entry for that PC1. This is what you need to do. Okay, so to look up the predictor, I have to actually do a comparison against every other PC that has been recorded over here. There are other complications as well. You know, once the table fills up and you want to put in a new entry, somebody else has to be thrown out, right? So instead of dealing with all of that, we will build a structure that is much simpler. Okay, so this structure has this table over here with a 2-bit entry. Okay, so you know, there's a prediction in each of these entries. Okay, and correspondingly, there might also be an entry which says that, you know, this branch tends to jump to PC3, this one tends to jump to PC4, and so on. Okay, and in this case, I've assumed a table with 1K entries. That's about 1,000 entries, which in binary corresponds to 1,024 entries. So there are entries numbered from 0 to 1,023. Okay, now every branch maps to one of these entries. Okay, and how do I figure out which entry it maps to? Let's look at my branch PC, right? In my example, this is PC1, right? So PC1 might be some 32-bit value, let's say. So, you know, it's a string of zeros and ones. All right. And what I do is I pick out 10 bits in the middle of this PC, right? So I pick out these 10 bits. And, you know, let's see what those 10 bits are. Let's, you know, for example, those bits might be this entry over here. Okay, so this says that entry number 1 is my entry in this table. Okay, so entry number 1 happens to be this entry over here, right? The very first entry is all zeros. The next entry is, you know, nine zeros followed by one, and so on, until you finally get to the very last entry, which is, you know, all ones. Okay, so to figure out which entry has been reserved for me, I just look at the middle 10 bits of my branch PC. That gives me a number between 0 and 1023, and that tells me which entry has been reserved for me. Okay, now it's possible that some other branch, you know, completely different branch with a different PC called PC5, you know, that may also have 10 bits in the middle which happen to match, you know, this entry over here. Okay, so this also maps to entry number 1. So this too maps over here. Okay, and this is called aliasing, where there are two different branches which happen to have the same index bits, right? So these bits are called the index bits because they tell me how to index into my table, right? So two different branches could have the same index bits, which means they're sharing one single entry. Okay, and this can lead to interference, right? Because you might have encountered PC1, which records what it did last time and where it jumped to. Then you encounter PC5, which says, you know, let me look at the predictor. Unfortunately, that predictor is telling me what PC1 did last time, right? So this ends up yielding a very bad prediction for PC5. Okay, and then when I go back to PC1, again, I have a bad prediction for PC1 because I have recorded PC5's information in my table. Okay, so when you have two different branches that map to the same location, you have this aliasing effect, which leads to interference and hence poor branch predictions. Okay, so, you know, this is something that we have to deal with because it is too complex to build a predictor like this where you have to, you know, search for your entry every single time. And if you make the entries large enough, the chances of having this aliasing also go down, right? So if it's going to be, you know, 4K entries, then you look at, you know, 12 bits for your index. And the probability of two 12-bit indices being the same is going to be lower than two 10-bit indices being the same. Okay, so by having a large enough predictor, you can reduce this aliasing effect. Okay, so we've talked about, you know, how you build a table for a branch predictor. And we've talked about a basic 1-bit predictor and a basic 2-bit predictor. And in the next video, I'll discuss correlating predictors.